Blog Talk Radio.
Warning.
Welcome to the 2 Minute Warning. Your sports fan sound.
I'm trying to blow your mind. I'm talking literally blow your mind. I'm trying to blow your mind. I'm talking literally blow your mind.
Here we go, Fight fans. We're back with yet another installment of the 2 Minute Warning, 5 Rules MMA podcast. Bringing the knowledge as usual, we got our host with us today. Even though we're one short, I'll call that from the dick. Omar's actually playing a silent partner in the background today. He's a little under the weather. His coach went and given him something. He had a trade on the mat, so he probably picked up a germ or two there. But in any event, we got Omar in spirit with us today. But besides that, Tommy, coming from Tom's River. Is it Tom's River? You move a little further south, right?
No, I moved to Barnegat. No more Tom's River for me.
Right. Yep. All right. So we got Tommy coming from Barnegat, and Chris on the other side of the studio with Studio Gucci.
Yeah, Chris on the other side of the wall. Literally.
On the other side of the wall. Playing the other
side. And then Tommy and the Minions on the Barnegat.
Tommy and the Minions in Barnegat.
Tommy took care of the Minions tonight.
Tommy took care of the Minions. All right. We all live lives. We all understand we have kids that we have to watch every once in a while. It happens. I, as usual, am the glue that holds the show together. Carl, what's good? What's good, people? Just pumped for this fight tonight. It's here. 207 is upon us. Going to get some answers to some questions we have. I'm curious to see what Rousey shows up. I'm curious to see if Cody can live up to the hype. And I'm curious about some of the undercards, too. There should be some exciting matchups that we're anticipating here at the show. But
Hendricks' last fight. I'm pretty sure this is going to be a
Johnny Hendricks missing weight. But let me just get into it real quick before we get any further. I do want to mention that we do have a guest caller today, Mike Burke from the Institute of Muay Thai in Kingsburg, New Jersey. He should be calling in about 8 o'clock. Got a chance to speak to Mike a little bit yesterday in the Great Lost episode of the Pride Rules podcast. We basically recorded a podcast for about a half hour yesterday. Everything was perfect. Everybody said exactly what we needed to say. It flowed perfectly. And unfortunately, we'll never get to put it out there to our guests because of Blog Talk issues. But in any event, Mike was good enough support to call back today. So I'm anticipating his call, and he definitely is a cool dude. Other than that, we got 207 here. I'm real souped about that. If you guys haven't already joined the group for 2 Minute Warning, do yourselves a favor and go out there and search 2 Minute Warning on Facebook and join the group. It's a great group. They're really good people over there, Trisha, Tim, all those, Sean, everybody over there is great. You know, it's filled with some douchebags, but hey, whatever, you need those out. But
yeah, you got
men,
2,000, 2K plus, you're going to get some douchebags the way it is.
Yeah, you got, I think it's like up to 2,500 members, which when I joined the group, it was 1,000 deep, and they've basically more than doubled, almost tripled now in size. So, you know, we're moving in the right direction. We got good things on the horizon in 2017, being that this is the last show in 2016. So, A lot to look forward to. But in any event, we do got Mike Burke calling in later. 207 is here. I wouldn't say it's the biggest story, but Chris touched on it before. The weight cutting issue, Johnny Hendricks now, I think that's the third time that he's missed weight. Last fight, he had to cut that big rig beard off, and he looked like an absolute creep. And still can't make the weight. I don't know what the deal is, but it seems like every card now, I don't know if it's because I'm paying more attention to it, but there's always an issue with the weight. I'm thinking there might be an issue down the road.
I think this almost lends to a bigger issue that we may or may not have touched on, but I think we should if we haven't, is how the UFC needs more weight classes.
Yeah.
They've talked about that. You know, Joe Rogan's talked about that. I think it's just way too many belts. It would be too much like boxing. Here's what I don't understand. Chris Weidman, when
there's
he fought David
fighters
Mike,
are there, though. There's enough fighters.
Yeah, but I understand that, but it would just be too confusing. When Weidman fought Damian Maia, he cut 32 pounds in 10 days. How can he do it, but Hendrick can't?
Well, right, and like I said the other day about Pettis, you know, he was on the Embedded episode in episode one ordering, like, steaks and shit. I mean, regardless of when that is in your fight camp, if you're cutting weight, you know you got to get down to 45, which is a tough weight for him to get down to. You shouldn't be eating that food ever. I think these guys just might not be disciplined enough, or they trust their system a little too much.
Listen,
go ahead.
The he's got a nutritionist that's ordering all his meals. He's not even thinking about that in fight week. He doesn't. That, the fighters, if you got your team in place, you're not thinking about what you're eating. That's all done for you. You eat what you're told to eat. So it's a failure on his entire team. It's not just him. You know, these guys hire people to do this for them. So if they fail, it's more than just him. And a lot of times, look, these guys hit a wall. The weight won't come off. That happens. You know, like Pettis, I respect. He tried. You know what I mean? Like, he tried to lose the
weight.
Pettis is a little
different.
You know, the doctor said no, you know? And like, look, man, if it's for the health of the fighter, I'm all I get it. You know what I mean? Sometimes they just don't make weight. They can't make weight. The doctor steps in. That's the way it goes sometimes. But when it becomes an issue, to me, is when it's habitual. So Hendrick's missing habitually. You got to move up, man. You know, like, but the problem is he's too small for middleweight, I think. You know, like, he's a shorter guy, and he's not really put together like a, you know, Yoel Romero's kind of short too, but he's not put together like, you know, athletically like that. So I think that he'll just really struggle. He's like one of those guys that are just without a weight class at the moment, you know. He's just
tough. He's going to have to go up and fight bigger guys, and that's just what it is, you know. It sucks, but you got to deal with it. You can't make the weight.
Either that or move out of the UFC.
Yeah, one or the other. But even still, how's he going to make the weight in another promotion?
I don't think it's in the cards for him, man. I don't think it is. I think that, like, for a guy that's been at the top like he has, you know, like, it's tough it's a tough pill to swallow to admit that, like, wow, I'm just now officially a gatekeeper in the UFC, you know, or worse, because if he has to move up, I don't know what he'll even do in the middleweight division.
He's
I don't know, you know, like, I think he'll get his ass whooped by those guys up there.
But,
personally.
I agree with you 100% on that.
Ray Borg, so it wasn't just Hendricks. I don't know how much Borg missed it by, but I think Hendricks missed it by 3. So two guys did miss weight. They're going to surrender 20% of their purse. That's really all that you know, that pertains to there. Another story coming out of the 207 thing, which we started to touch on yesterday, which I got to bring back up because I think it had legs to it, this whole Nunez-Rousey thing. And I know, guys, we might be saying the same thing we said yesterday, but I don't want to shortchange our listeners with our opinions. So, you know, we might have to just run through this again. It's the whole, you know.
Dude, like, stop saying it. We were there. We know what happened. We're just going to go on with the show.
I'm just saying. I'm going to say it once and go forward with it. But, you know, the whole Amanda Nunes really getting swept under the rug. You know, she's back on the fight poster. Chris, you alluded to a sports column article we saw online, which referred to Nunes as Rousey's opponent. Like, this girl's getting disrespected.
Yeah, it's like, it doesn't even say Amanda Nunes misses press conference. It says Ronda Rousey's opponent, no shows press conference. So, like, she's really not even getting – she's the champion, mind you. She's not getting any kind type of respect whatsoever, which, you know.
Which is not
– I guess
not right.
I get it.
Aside from the fact
I get it, though. You know, I even get it. And Nunes isn't even upset about it to a degree. She's just like, I get, you know, she gets it,
she
too.
She should be.
Ronda's the
she
star.
Should be upset. We all get it, but she still should be upset about it. She's not getting a fair
You know,
fight.
Everybody, like,
you know.
The way Nunes is taking this is, like, she's not taking any emotion into it and not taking it as, like, you know, there's nothing she can do about
she's
it.
Smart.
She's just going to go out there and do her job, and I respect that. You know, she's
right.
not putting
I
any
do.
Thought into that.
I respect it, too. I just think it's not fair. In the end, you know, you're cheating yourself out of a couple of dollars. It's basically what happens. You know, the bottom line is.
Yeah, I think it's unfair because Nunes doesn't get the opportunity to, like, really showcase herself to the public the way she should in a big fight like this. Like, the, you know, what's surrounding this fight is everything. This is the return of Ronda Rousey. This is, like, women's MMA is back as the world knew it.
And not for
she's
nothing.
Not getting a chance to shine on that platform that anyone else that's fought Ronda has had in the past.
Think about Conor McGregor not doing a press conference or anything before his fights. Like, I understand we've gone down that road where he said, you know, oh, I don't want to come do media tours, but he would have gone to the one press conference and did the pre-fight presser and everything, but just not hearing the voice. I can't imagine. A, it's not fair because Conor got ripped off 200 for it. B, it definitely doesn't do Nunes any favors, and C, it's honestly not doing Rousey any favors because the general.
Yeah, and I don't want to hear. Yeah, I don't want to hear that. Like, oh, she's just focused on winning look, everybody,
yeah.
Nick Diaz, Nate Diaz, they hate to do in the press. They got to do it. You know, Connor didn't want to do the press. He got taken off a card. Like, it's just the way it is. I understand, like, you know, maybe we might, Tommy made a point, like, we might get to see a better fight because of it. Well, maybe, but,
maybe not.
You know, maybe not. Maybe there's going to be some less animosity towards each other because they haven't had a chance to talk to the media. And, like, there's, I don't know. You know, like, this is the least hyped fight I could remember. Like, this should be huge. It's Ronda Rousey's return, and it's really not.
I
think it should be made.
Well, it's also a little bit harder for, like you said last night, for it to be huge because it's on a Friday night. It's an odd night. You know, nobody's really used to a pay-per-view being on a Friday night. Like you said yesterday, the last time a pay-per-view was on a Friday was when Brock Lesnar fought Overeem. I mean, they did 600,000 pay-per-view buys,
and that's what
which
I was
going to say. Number,
that was heavyweight men, so they I guarantee that, and it was Brock. You know, but like that's my point. Like, if it was Conor McGregor, this is supposed to be Ronda Rousey here, who's the biggest, baddest draw and the, you know, the biggest star the UFC ever had.
Yeah, but it's also coming her.
I don't give a fuck if it was
a Tuesday night.
If it was a Tuesday night and it was Conor McGregor, this shit would break records. You know, it would almost add to the.
You can't compare the two.
I understand that, right? No comparing Conor, but hey, forget
but
on what night of the week it's on. It has to do with the New Year's Eve, and they're just not. UFC fight fans are going to tune into it no matter what. I'm just saying. Nunez is not getting a fair shake. You know, I just don't think it's fair. I think they're selling Rousey still too much, and they're burying the Nunez under the rug. And personally, I don't think Rousey's going to continue fighting, win or lose. I don't know if she's going forward going to stay remain active. So they might want to give her a swan song, her you know, going away present by hyping her all out the ass. But, you know, I just don't think it's fair for Nunez. I think the bottom line is dollars. You know, she's the first openly gay championship athlete in any sport. And I think it would do wonders for that aspect. I know Omar touched on it the other day, talking about this when we did our pre-fight, pre-show talk on how these, you know, they will support her. People will come out. That's a fan base that you haven't really tapped into much yet that you could bring in. And mostly women, not for nothing, which is two demographics that are outside the normal realm of what your fan base is usually creating. So I think there's a chance of them generating something here for them.
I don't even think that the UFC has any interest in generating a new fan base based off of Amanda Nunes, and it's evident by. But I'm not saying it's not. I'm saying it's just evident by the way they've handled the situation. It doesn't look like they're trying to win over anybody right now. It really just looks like it's all Ronda's call, and you know it's about. Really, they're not even into pleasing her fans because, you know, they should be forcing Ronda into talking. I know a lot of fans are turning their back on her because.
100%.
Because she feels the way, you know, they feel mistreated, but just disrespected because, you know, Ronda doesn't have time for anything. She has no time for them.
It's the truth, right.
And
yeah,
I think
you can't come to an hour at a press conference? Like, who the hell do you think you are? I mean, come on, man. It's like you're making one fighter bigger than the sport, bigger than the organization. And, you know, I don't want to seem hypocritical when I talk about Connor. I also agree that Connor should have had to do the press conferences and everything, but with him it was a different situation. You had a pullout. You had him going around the world twice, two world tours for Aldo. The first time he had to do two different interviews because he was fighting Aldo, then he was fighting Chad. So he had to answer the same questions. But it's a little bit different of an aspect. But I also agree that he should still have to do the press conferences for the UFC. Don't do all the other ESPN shit, but do the press conferences for UFC for free, and you should be obligated to do the best. That's what you earn your money for.
You know what? Those same fans that you talked about that are kind of turning their back on her, if she wins tonight, they'll be right back. And you know why? Because they're fair weather fans. Who gives a shit if somebody's doing an interview? That's the point that I always keep trying to make. Who cares? It's not like it's the first time we've ever seen either of them fight. They don't have animosity towards each other because
Tommy. That's where you create sound bites. That's where you create. Highlight reels. That's where you create these memes that stand the test of time. Basically, that's how you build the sport. And it sounds trivial, but it's not. It's really not. Who the fuck is that guy that will live in infamy for the next 30 years? Because the people that were around when that fight and that comment was made and that care about UFC will always laugh at that because they know where they were when they heard that. They remember the time of the big card and everything.
Yeah, but it made Stevens look like a dickhead because he said he could be the one to knock out Connor. And he couldn't
finish
Frankie. So, It makes them look like an idiot. So this is what I mean. Like,
when they
get made to look like a fool. Just keep your mouth shut. That was Ronda's problem the first time.
Yeah, well, hey, what you're saying is even not to jump subjects here, but what you're saying right now is
how
we talk about Connery when you're a loudmouth and you talk shit and then you back it up. You're putting more pressure on yourself. You're raising the stakes on your own, putting a whole deep load of pressure on your own back. It's crazy. And to come through,
well, defending a belt defending a belt is enough pressure, especially defending it against, you know, the first woman's champion.
Right
in
away,
UFC.
Contradicting his own statement. You know? Ronda created too much pressure. Spending the belt wasn't enough pressure. She,
what are you talking about?
Like,
talking about Nunez.
Talking about Ronda when we were talking about her not doing interviews. Right?
I was talking about Conor for a second, and all I care about is Conor right now.
Well, Conor's not fighting tonight. Conor's not fighting for a while, so get him out of your spank bank. And worry about what's going on ahead of us.
Defending the belt isn't creating any pressure, so he has to create his by fucking talking shit, is what essentially Tommy's saying.
Listen, Tommy's never talked shit in his life.
Well, that's
ever.
A full out and out lie.
Oh, man.
That's a full out and out lie. But
so
we're not talking
all
about
all, at least we get to see what's going to happen tonight. You know, all the talk is over, and they're literally a mere hours away from fighting. So, you know, by the
there
time
no
most
talk.
People hear this,
there hasn't been any talk. All no
yeah,
talk
right.
is over.
By the time most fans,
I can tell you who's been doing a lot of talking, and it's Cody Garbrandt. Honestly, I don't like Dominic Cruz, but I want to see Cruz just destroy him. I really do.
I don't think.
But he really played
he's
himself, man. He made himself look like a fucking child.
That fucking part that he has in his hair just pisses me off.
Is this
I can't
really
stand that
the
look.
One, three of us, the two of us, agree with Tommy right now?
I know. I'm sick. I'm trying to figure out a way to make fun of him. Tommy, you just like him or something? You have a crush on him? Are you jealous? Is that what it is?
Who? Do I not? Why don't I like Cody Garbrandt?
Because he's so hot.
Because he's a number five ranked fighter who really hasn't fought anybody that impressive, and he gets to fight Dominic Cruz, and he's going to get made to look like an asshole.
Well, he'll be brought down
Cruz,
to reality pretty
quick.
He had
a statement today that really stood out to me, or he didn't have it today. I just heard it today. And he was like, if his whole game plan is to come in there and knock me out, then he already lost. Because and I couldn't be more, you know, I couldn't agree more.
Absolutely.
Oh, right.
You know, like, you better get in there with a plan more than I'm going to catch this guy. Because catching Dominic Cruz, hey, catching him is one thing. You still got to knock him out. Like, hitting him and then hitting him flush are two different things. I'm sure he's going to get hit, but it's not like Dom's been finished before by punches. You know what I mean? Like, Faber dropped him, but he get
everyone. Everyone keeps saying, oh, if Cody catches him, that's it. No, he's got to catch him flush, knock him down, jump on him. And, you know, he doesn't just – one punch doesn't just end this fight. It's not – you know, don't guarantee that he's going to hit him on the button and knock him out. So Cody's got a tough job ahead of him. I hope he knows that. He's been acting like he should, I guess, back acting like brash, like, you know, I'm 24 hours away from winning my belt, this and that, you know, all over social media. So I respect that, but – you know, I hope he realizes what he's got ahead of him. Fucking dog.
He's too flat. He's way too flat-footed for Cruz.
Right,
you know, you could
look at his last knockout.
You know,
absolutely. Dillashaw kind of resembles Dom lately. You know, not as good, but you know, he sort of resembles him with his movement lately. You know, all over the place, kicking. I want to get to what Chris said about Dom about how he his like side leg kick or whatever, but when you look at Cody's last knockout, the dude was like cocked back. Guy bounced off the cage. He cocked back with his right hand and hit him with a shot. He ain't going to be in a position to do that to Dom. I'm sorry. That's
yeah, the Almeida
happen,
fight
so.
You're talking about. Like, dude, yeah, those sloppy wide punches, that you better come more straight down the pipe against Cruz, because those wide punches, that's like, you know, looking at the ground and throwing an overhand right and praying for the fucking best. I don't see it, man. Like, I don't know, man.
I don't see it either.
I mean, we all picked Cruz, so we all obviously are in lockstep on what we think is going to happen.
Cruz doesn't ever stand in the pocket, and that's what Cody's going to basically need for him to do is stand in the pocket and go, you know, guns blazing for him to hit those wild looping punches. And I just don't see it. I see the 1-2, like I've seen so many times with the combination that Dominic throws, like you alluded to before, Carl, was he throws the 1-2 in the leg kick, but he hits a leg kick like across the front of both legs because he's like creates such an angle that he's like almost past you when he throws it. It's fucking impressive, man. His footwork
gets to the side of you, right?
His footwork sets up like literally you can't miss scores. You know, like he'll hit three shots or two punches and a leg kick that the guy has no chance at defending against because of the angles he creates with his footwork. It's fucking really, it's crazy to watch. And I never liked Tom, man. And I feel like the kind of the public has been like this, and now lately Dom has kind of won the public over with his Fox gig and
He's
I don't know, like he got
people are used to seeing him. Right,
yeah,
no,
yeah,
you know
yeah,
what?
And like,
I don't know about you guys, but I know everybody says, you know, he's great when he's commentating. He just has no energy. Yeah, he's smart, but I don't think he's that great of a commentator.
It's not even about that with me. I'm not even talking about his commentating skills. I'm just saying that in terms of
the fans
getting behind him now because he's a guy that everybody knows. He's well-spoken.
Know.
You know, he's well-spoken.
Eye.
And truth is, like, you know, he is a smart guy. And he's been on the top for a fucking long time, man. You know,
a quick question
really...
for you. Who fights left, Aldo or Cruz?
Aldo.
That, how about this? The crazy part is Dominic Cruz had legitimate fucking injuries, though, and really
right.
fought his ass off to get back. I give Cruz all the credit in the world because, you know, that's a career-ending shit, man. Like, he was 3 years off, and at a level that he
remember?
Was at in the back. I think that, and the fact is, it's almost like if you look at their tenure, Cruz probably has as many fights over the amount of time as Aldo. And that's a shame because Aldo hasn't been as injured as Cruz.
You remember the story that Rondo was the one that blew out Cruz's knee when they were on the when he was on the Ultimate Fighter, when he had to have his knee operated on after that?
I don't remember that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it was. They say it was a rumor, but I know she was training with him.
Yeah, I mean, who knows?
Those things happen.
That's gym shit.
We
should know that.
Exactly. But what about this, guys? We talk about, oh, Cody's not going to hit Dom, his movement. You know, I, for one, think one of Conor's biggest assets is his movement. And, like, these guys look, like Dillashaw, they look different. They're not the same fighter, you know, like, it's almost like a carbon copy of fight. There's a rhythm, there's a flow to it. These certain guys fight on that off rhythm. Emil Mech.
Yeah, there's like they beat a little bit, and they're awkward, and it makes them hard to game plan for.
So
you know, even like the Machida, the karate to anyone. You know, like Wonderboy is another good example. They just move a little bit different, and guys can't figure them out, which is really
tricky. There's only so much pad work. Transitions on the ground you can work. Like, after a while, there's not much new shit that can come out. So I think that this is kind of something that fighters are going to start looking into to advance their skill set and game because that is a big aspect of it. I think movement has a lot to do with fighting. Like, you look at Floyd Mayweather,
is everything
a boxer,
with fighting? I mean,
right?
Of course.
It's slow. When you're used to seeing certain movements, it slows down for you. It's like a quarterback going from freshman to sophomore year or rookie to second year. The game slows down. It doesn't really slow down, but their mind processes things quicker. So you can see a punch coming the right way. When you're used to certain movements that other fighters aren't, you can create those weird angles, which create openings, which create offbeat shots that land, that knock your opponent out and hurt them bad. But that's where I think the sport should evolve to next. And we're watching the transition now, and I think guys like Ido Portal, and I don't even know any other coaches that train.
Oh, get off his dick, dude.
I just don't know any other. That's
oh, thank God.
Kid.
You know what? You know what, Chris?
Listen, this is the one time I'm making a point, and not for nothing. My point is right.
God.
And you guys can say what you want. I'm not jocking Ido
Portal.
Yeah, no,
it is right. It's to a degree, it's right, but I think that you're going a little too, you know, like movement has always been about fighting's always been about movement, and it's always been about gaining finding that next thing. And but just some guys have it and some guys don't. You could see, you know, Gunnar Nelson train with Ido Portal and see Conor McGregor train with Ido Portal. Gunnar Nelson's not going to become a world beater because he's training with the guy. You know, Artem Mobrov isn't going to become a world beater.
Guys,
like, either you have it or you don't.
Yeah, and you also had the Chuck Liddells back in the day and the guys who were training the same way as Chuck Liddell that didn't get it the same way. So it's relative. It's across the board. It's retroactive. That is the case in every skill set. So, yes, I agree with you, but I'm saying those that do grasp it and learn it the right way will be able to excel their skill set further than a guy who can't do that. And I think that
there's more than there's more than one skin a cat, some will say, but then some will say, well, there's only one right way to skin a cat. In MMA training, it's not that case. Like, there's a million ways to do things in – and it really depends on the fighter, who's good at what. Like, you know, people tend to think nowadays that, like, all right, I wrestled my whole career, my whole life, so now I become a UFC fighter, I have wrestling, so I'm not going to work on that anymore. And then you become almost, you almost start creating holes in your what should be your strength by not keeping up with the
exactly.
basics of
Mark
what
Coleman,
got you there.
Perfect example, Mark the Hammer Coleman. He stuck with one style, it didn't work.
All that,
you know?
Brought you, bro. Like, you know, like, you became a UFC fighter based off of your wrestling. So wrestle, you know, like, wrestle. The other stuff will come. You learn defensively how to do the other stuff. But, you know, everybody's got different skill sets. So training, you know, it really is relative to the fighter. And it really takes – that's why I think certain coaches, man, are better than others, because – you know, they really do better, you know, with one-on-one shit. When you have a team and you have just a certain rigorous way of training and everyone does the same thing, you tend to get a bunch of guys that are doing shit that aren't working for them, you know? So,
well, yeah, I mean, obviously, that's breaking down fighting and breaking down training, and, you know, this is all fun. I would love to sit here and do it for 4 hours with you guys. I mean, I could definitely talk about it, and it's just the evolution of the sport. I like it. Being able to look at it from afar and spot different pockets of change and being able to...
You got Cody calling himself, like, the new wave, the hybrid fighter. But there's always going to be that. You know,
right.
Like, there's no such thing as that anymore. Like, that happened when Vitor Belfort came along. You know what I mean? And, like, that was... You know, like, it's no different. People always want to see, like, oh, he's the new breed, hybrid. No, Vitor was a striker that had great grappling, Brazilian jiu-jitsu background. You know,
mm-hmm.
Cody Garbrandt
and
isn't
steroids.
The first of... Yeah, but my point
steroids.
Is I'm talking about 19-year-old Vitor back in the day. Steroids or not, he was a fucking freak of, you know, a freak of nature. And the reality is, that's what these guys now, the upstarts, the up-and-coming guys, they want to consider themselves the hybrid. No, no, you're no different now. You're just a new young guy.
You're
you know,
a mixed,
like,
martial artist.
Yeah. It's been like this for a long time where everybody's been doing everything, you know? It's been like that for a real long time.
Yeah, but you know what? Then you got guys like our caller that's going to be calling in right about now, Mike Burke, who just think that Muay Thai is the way. They just think that it's that one style.
Yeah, and you
way.
Think the same way about jiu-jitsu, so eat it. You both do. So does Omar. You all can kiss my ass, you son of a bitch, you hypocrite.
Yo.
So,
there he is.
Yo, what's up?
Can you guys hear me now?
Hold on, let's try this fucking shit again, huh?
Hey, Mike, you got a parrot on your shoulder
pajama party?
You got
it sure is.
Now, listen, I hope you guys got, like, the super server this time, the mega server to handle
all the Mike Burke fans from last night crashed the servers.
Dude, how legendary!
Radio.
How legendary is that? That you guys put me on. You guys had on UFC fighters and it crashed the server. That's crazy.
That's so true.
You're more popular than the Ultimate Fighter winners. I love it.
The Ultimate Fighter winners. Hey, listen, thanks for having me on again. I appreciate it, man.
Absolutely, Mike
man,
Burke.
We wanted you on.
I want to let me introduce him officially to the fans, any listeners out there. This gentleman that you hear in the background, Mike Burke. He is the owner of the Institute of Muay Thai Gym in Keensburg, New Jersey, where they train Muay Thai. Apparently, obviously.
Eric,
this is day two of the interview. We left parrots at home. We put the kids to bed. Everything's good. This is late night. You know, we're basically doing our own fight companion. The prelims go off. How you doing, Mike?
Hey, man, I'm doing awesome. We just got done with Friday night practice and getting ready for some big fights they have coming up, man. I appreciate you guys having me on to promote that. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, I really appreciate you coming on, and I definitely want to give you a chance to promote whatever you got going on going forward, and you know, talk a little bit about your gym. Tommy's pretty excited to have you on, and we're grateful that Tommy was able to contact you and that you agreed upon it. So, you know, it's just good to have. I just want to know how
how have you even lasted this long with a relationship with a guy like him? I mean, he's such a pain in the ass. All his views are so cockamamie and ass backwards. I can't imagine.
You're 100%. Here's the secret. Never actually talk to the guy. Right?
Yo, that's what I do.
Yeah, absolutely zero contact, and then you can stay friends forever.
As you can tell, I've scraped the bottom of the barrel with the guests. I'm kind of running out of good stuff to get. You know what I mean?
It's that neighborhood Muay Thai guy. He'll come on. He'll talk to anybody.
Oh, man, I love it.
That guy loves to hear stuff talk.
You're goddamn right, I do.
Do you have... Do you have any other social media that you want to plug? I mean, I know your Facebook page, the Institute of Muay Thai, is out there for our listeners to get out there and like you and plugging it, sharing your team page or your gym page, I should say. But,
so the Institute of Muay Thai is on Facebook. But how about this? How about go on Facebook and check out Frank Wells? He's one of our top fighters. Malcolm Hill, he's another one of our fighters. John Esposito, he has a huge fight coming up. He's going for the 160 USMTA belt at the Warriors Cup in February.
Nice.
We've got Anthony Caparo.
The guys got to get on the show. We got to let these guys get on the show and promote their fights a little bit, too, I think.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah,
They're a bunch of characters. See, you guys would love to have them on. I mean, they're good dudes,
so
man.
So far, so
we're
good.
Hoping,
you're right up our alley.
Tonight. We want them to call in tonight while you're on.
Dude, you don't think I prepared for this? I just had practice, so I know they're all on the road right now, and they're not allowed to talk on the phone and drive at the same time. So, no, nobody's calling in, bro.
Yo, he straight up said, he was like, I really hope nobody calls in and busts my balls. Like, he straight up said it on social media. That's hilarious. you beat me to the punch because I did look at I was surfing the web and looking at your gym page and everything, and it seems like you guys are very team-oriented. It's almost like family-oriented over there. So I was going to ask you, what big fighters you had out there and if any names were on the horizon, but it seems like you already put us down to that. So that's pretty good. It must feel good to actually turn out guys who were able to take your skills, your training, and put it to good use, and to show that, hey, this is working what I do.
Dude, it's really freaking awesome because I trained under guys like John Potenza and Chris China Weapons. And so the things that they taught me, now I'm teaching other dudes, and these guys are going in the ring and working for me, So it's a really cool feeling to be part of that.
Yeah, it's got to be rewarding, see it all come to fruition. It's definitely something that's probably surreal when it first starts to happen. Your first guy that's trained and put him through the ringer, and then he goes out there and wins. Like, the emotion, levels and spikes, the valleys. It's got to be a great thing.
Dude, you hit it on the you hit the nail on the head. Like, the roller coaster of emotions that go into, the coaching aspect of it, because when they win, that's all on them, obviously. But when they lose, man, I take that shit serious. Wow. I really
absolutely.
You get more nervous for them.
Right,
I remember
watching
my sister fight. I felt way more nervous for her fight than any fight I've ever been in my life.
Mind you, this is a street fight. A girl that she just beat the shit out of in the back streets of the school. It's not a sanctioned fight by any stretch, but still.
I was about to say, when the hell did your sister fight?
She fought some chick in the back of 7-Eleven or what?
Basically, I saw this.
I don't
want to
name drop, but you know who she is, the girl.
I saw this girl 2 weeks later, and I was like, who just got into a car accident? And I was like, no, holy shit, that's the shit my sister gets into a fight with. I mean, Mike, Tommy, Lindsay, this girl's a bull. She's been a bull. She played football with the guys, and she's not like a big chick. She's very feminine too, and she's tough as hell. It's pretty funny watching her work, but
it seems like Chris, Roxanne, and Lindsay got all the tough jeans, and Carl was just there.
You better hope to wrap me up, because God forbid I get these hands on you. That's why when Mike opens or when I get into the gym, I'm going to start training Muay Thai so my punches and kicks land a little extra harder, just so I can put a little oomph into it to teach you who's boss, Tommy.
Hell yeah.
Won't be a problem.
Put some Christmas paper around it and give those hands a gift, man.
won't be a problem.
Right. Well, Mike, how long you been actually doing this? How long you been at the training thing?
I started training guys I guess, 6 or 7 years ago.
Nice.
And then
nice.
The Institute became official 3-4 years ago. But I've been subleasing out of other gyms, so it's never been, I've never actually had like my own building or our own home, our own gym. I've always subleased mat space. Kind of like what, and I'm not comparing myself to him at all, but like what Mark Henry does, he trains out of like Catones, he trains his guys out of, who's the other one?
Gray Longo?
No. Whatever. But yeah, that's what I'm doing. I've been training out of like boxing gyms and wrestling gyms and shit like that. And then on Sunday, we're finally going to have our own spot, dude. So I'm super pumped about that.
Yeah, that's got to be a big moment for y'all. I'm pretty psyched for you. That's definitely pretty cool. Now, question I wanted to ask you yesterday, but why Muay Thai? Why, you know, like I'm stuck here with three jiu-jitsu dudes who, you know, they're so dead set in their ways, and I can't really sway, so I know what I'm getting into here, so it's like a breath of fresh air to have somebody that actually knows something about striking. But why Muay Thai? Why didn't go down another road? Was it something that you just trained when you were younger and just stuck with it?
No, well, first of all, somebody's got their radio on because the echo is fucking terrible right now.
Really?
No, that's just this blog talk crap.
All right. It wasn't doing that yesterday. Yesterday is the kids in the parrots, and today it's the fucking echo, man.
Yeah, this is hopefully one of our last shows on this, so we can move on to greener pastures. So
I just hate the technical difficulties.
Boy, I guess when I was a kid, I did what everybody else did. I was at your corner like karate shop, the PAL boxing. I started getting into like just kickboxing, coming up a little bit, and then I started taking Kyokushin karate, which is like more of a. That's like the Kyokushin karate is kind of like the grandfather of Dutch kickboxing. You know,
that's style. Didn't that Liddell did? Didn't Liddell do Kyokushin?
No, I don't think so. No, him and Hackman or whatever that guy's name is, I think they created their own shit.
Tommy, can you get your facts straight before you try to drop knowledge? You've been wrong every time you smoke.
But he is.
Are you looking in the mirror when you say that?
It is some kind of karate, for sure. Let's fact check. Well, I could be wrong. I don't know. I don't know MMA, dude. Like, you ask me MMA questions. I don't know.
Tragic.
Oh, I love it.
Yo, how about the kid tonight that's going to fight that's got the black belt and neck tattoos?
Oh,
Cody Garbrandt.
Yeah, what a douche, huh?
Yeah, we actually need to be talking about that.
Yo, I'll agree with that 100%.
Dude, there's him and the guy that he's fighting. I hope it's like a double knockout. They're both so douchey.
Yeah, I've seen somebody else in the cruise.
That's great. I
don't know.
They're so boring. That's what it is. It's just, you know, Dom's boring. He's a shit talker, but he's boring. And Cody's trying to drum up some, you know, some excitement for it. And I get it. He's got that striking ability. So it could be an exciting knockout. But I don't know, man. Dom's skill set. I mean, we did just talk about it. But what do you think? You obviously think you hope it's a double knockout. But, you know, I'm assuming you think Dom, with the skill set that he possesses, is taking this one.
I think the dude Cruz has a really unique skill set. I think that, and I'm not saying anything new, right? I'm not dropping any fucking wisdom here. But, like, he's got a really unique skill set. Like, when I've watched him fight, his footwork, his head movement, his angles are different than most guys. So that's really got to be hard to that's got to be hard to deal with.
Absolutely.
And Cody seems like he's a real standard like boxer, like has really good hands.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. From what you've said so far, you're pretty spot on.
Yeah, I mean we just basically said it too, so it's kind of refreshing knowing that somebody who knows what they're talking about, not just three idiots here. You agree with us, so that's pretty cool. But
thing I don't understand is how Cruz hurts people. Does he finish people, or is he only win decisions?
They call him the decisionator.
Oh shit! How funny is that? Because when he's landing a lot of shots, and man, I'm no like genius in this shit, but when I'm watching him fight, it's like he's landing shots and his body weight's going in other directions. So it's hard to, like, how would you ever put anybody down? You know what I mean? There's only a couple dudes in the world that have power where you can be going in a different direction and hurt somebody, like, in MMA. Anderson Silva, right?
Yeah.
He could be going backwards and touch you with a jab and break your jaw. He's got weird freakish.
Yeah, that would look. I mean, I felt bad for Forrest Griffin. That was embarrassing. I mean, he just stood there, move.
Anderson Silva
looked anything more like a fucking Jedi that night? That was ridiculous.
No, like he was in the Matrix.
Yeah, but Forrest Griffin had gotten knocked out in training like six times before that fight. He should have either not been sparring or not have taken that fight.
That's cool. That's totally, but that has nothing to do with Anderson Silva's like awareness of spacing and distance.
Ability to touch you, but go moving backwards and knock you out.
Dude, and the fact that he was like, dude, his hands were down, and he knew exactly where to be at the end of Forrest Griffin's punches. I mean, he was an inch away every single time. That's freakish, man. That's freakish.
Good analysis right there. And
you know
who else,
the Irish guy?
Conor
McGregor.
I was just
going to
say that.
He's got dynamite in his hands.
He has the perfect
Oh, God, here we go. Another blowfest.
Listen. What he did with Alvarez, my brother, I got to give him credit in the other room. He said, you know, he put Alvarez at the very end of every one of those punches. He was hitting him at the perfect spot, and it just does the most damage. The guy has friggin' bricks in his hands, man.
Dude, he really does.
You look at what Jose...
No, that's what I'm saying. It's not only does he have the power that he has the range and the timing and the distance down so perfect that when you... It's so unique.
Distance is a big thing. When you catch somebody at the end of that punch, like you can catch somebody with a close punch, it's not going to hit him as much. Once you get extended and get your other muscles into it, your momentum, that's what really gives you that power.
His accuracy is so pinpoint when he hits you behind the ear, and it's by design. That's, you know, you don't see
and
many
listen,
guys doing
honestly, it. This is like no bullshit. There's dudes who are just born, and I don't know what it is. Kind of like how, you know what's a cool analogy? You know how when Michael Jordan jumped, he would kind of just like, he stayed in the air a fraction of a second longer.
Yeah, it was like watching something different.
It's just something different. There's dudes who are born, like I've trained with dudes who they could be going like real technical but and real light, but when their hands touch you, it feels different than when like a normal human being's hands touch you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can see it in any sport. It could be a guy swinging a baseball bat. If that's his gift, he just, you know, it looks like he's swinging it effortless and the ball goes 450 feet. You know what I mean?
There's some guys out there that I don't know what it is, and I don't think anybody really does, but they're just born with these with dynamite in their hands, and they just touch you and you fucking die.
Yeah.
It's the Tim Mark of MMA is what it is, bro. It's the touch of death.
Born to be played, I guess. Freaking awesome. Have you ever fought any, you know, amateur professional?
At a really, really low level, man. At a really, like, unsanctioned smokers.
You'll be able to test your stuff.
That's great. I would love to
do
that.
Yeah, so when I came up, as I was coming up, like, I did all the, like, the tournaments, and then when I got into Muay Thai, I got a bunch of smokers, which are just their fights, but they're unsanctioned fights.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I didn't fight anywhere at the level of where, like, my guys are now, you know what I mean? And like, for real fighters, like, real fighters where they fight, I never fought them.
You want me to ask it, how old are you, actually? I didn't want
to. Dude, what the fuck? I'm like 22.
Me too.
Oh shit, I got a bunch of laughs.
Me too.
Yeah, I am getting
shit.
Old.
Shit, I'm about to be 40,
I'm
man.
I'm 39 years old actually.
Okay, I'm 30. I'll be 37 in a month, literally. So that's cool. We're this, of the same generation roughly.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Wow, we got two guys on the show that got to see the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. That's awesome.
Wow, you're doing.
Yo, hey Tony.
So, as we were coming up, like our age group, as we were coming up, we didn't have like a lot of the opportunities.
Wasn't cool
to
be a fighter.
Hey, I remember the early days of the UFC. Like, you know, these guys are coming out in wrestling shoes sometimes, you know, in the fight. One guy's barefoot, one guy's in wrestling.
Yeah,
dude.
I remember thinking
I watched
to myself,
every UFC. I was such an MMA fanatic when you could rent on pay-per-view UFC 1 through UFC 10.
Yeah.
That's so great.
Watch Gracie hold on to Kimo's hair. For 15 straight minutes, there was hair all over the octagon by the end of the fucking fight.
100%, dude. Or how about when Royce Gracie laid, I think it was underneath Ken Shamrock for 35 minutes?
Yeah.
Oh, that was you. That was the second one, I think.
That was the draw.
Was that UFC 2?
I was a big fan back then, man. I really loved that shit. I didn't have enough balls. Like, I never...
Yo, and back then, if you were training back in the day, it wasn't the way it is now, where it's like a business. And they want to keep you around. Like, they kicked your ass until you left the gym. Like, you had to be a badass to train back in the day.
So, yeah, right. So, and the funny thing is, like, I talk to old-timers about this all the time. Like, when we used to train, we didn't have, like, Friday Night Fights, Warriors Cup, shit like that, where you could actually go and have, like, these, as an amateur, these really great professional promotions.
Mm-hmm. To go watch and aspire to be.
Yeah, so we had, like, our team would go over to another gym. And then
yes.
our coach would be like, yeah, you guys are about the same
size.
It would
be like town beef type shit, like, you know.
Yeah,
so
the coach would line up.
So
like,
fucking
all right,
ghetto,
you weigh
bro.
About the same. You guys look the same height, weight. Let's go. Let's fight here. You know, like, you see those old
yeah,
school
dude,
teams.
Yeah,
of
I got
course,
my dick
the
kicked
Nate
so many times because, of, like, I'm a tall, skinny kid, and they put me up against like, somebody who's, like, 15 years older than me. You know what I mean? You know
what I mean? Yeah.
Oh,
so
man.
Mike,
yeah.
Mike, you were telling me one of your fighters has a fight at Lion Fight, right?
Yeah, Anthony Creparo. He fought at Lion Fight a couple months ago, and he's going to be fighting again. Hopefully, if Scott Kent, if you're listening, brother, we get that matchup pretty soon because he's slated to fight on their next show in March.
Now,
awesome.
where can everybody watch Lion Fight? What channel?
Access TV.
Okay.
Okay. Well, what do you say? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
Access TV, ASS.
Access, okay. Yep, gotcha.
Yeah, well, I'm going to message you later on, and we'll get the actual details so we can start plugging that and, like, actually posting it on our social media, get the word out there for that.
Wait till the matchup comes in. I don't like to promote this shit until
of course.
Started, you know what I mean?
I don't want to jump the gun, but,
yeah. We'll wait for you guys.
So, Mike, can you explain to our listeners, you know, some of them might not know Muay Thai, what's the difference between Lion Fight and Glory?
Awesome. So,
yeah,
well, let me break down, like, I'm so passionate about this topic, man. All right,
good.
So you guys are, like, huge MMA guys, which MMA is a phenomenal sport, and dudes have to be, like, really, really proficient in a lot of different aspects of the fight game. And the one thing that I've noticed is, like, when I watch an MMA bout, the crowd gets really impatient when it becomes a jiu-jitsu match or it becomes a wrestling match, and they want to see dudes stand up and fight, right?
Yeah.
And I would say that most of
the like,
which
I have mixed feelings
those,
about, but we're getting to that at a different time. Keep going.
I'm with you 100%, and I was just going to say most of those people are, like, your uneducated, untrained guys. Like, even though I don't train in jiu-jitsu, and I bust guys' balls about jiu-jitsu all the time, I love to watch skilled jiu-jitsu guys or skilled wrestlers go at it. It's fantastic. You know what I mean? But if you're looking for a slugfest, it's not exciting. So Glory came around, and Glory is a stand-up style of kickboxing that really caters to, like, a duck style where there's no clinch. It's limited clinch. I think you're
so it's basically like just stand there, rock and sock kind of. You got to bang out.
Yes, 100%. They're short rounds. They're short fights. They're only three rounds, three-minute fights, three-minute rounds. So you're swinging for the fences. It's a sprint. It's not where a lot of MMA matches, especially the ones that go five rounds, it's more of a marathon. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's why you see a lot of these guys have, like, 100 fights.
Well, the Muay Thai guys, they're fighting five rounds, and each round is 3 minutes. So those Muay Thai guys that have 150 fights and shit like that, they've been fighting since they're like eight.
Yes.
Yeah.
But let me just get back. So you got MMA where it's the whole package, right? You have the ground game, you've got the transitional game, and you've got the stand-up. Then you've got Muay Thai where Muay Thai is the stand-up art where we utilize the clinch a lot. We utilize our elbows and our knees, throws and dumps, and, of course, like punches and kicks. And then I guess the next step away from that would be Glory, where it's the punches and kicks and knees, no elbows, no clinch.
Wow, okay.
Wow.
Now, can you do the clinch takedowns in Lion Fight?
Yes. Lion Fight is the –
You make it get – stand it right back up, though?
Yeah, so there's nothing – yeah, so as soon as you get – it's not – it's – it's a takedown, I guess you could say, but you're not following your guy to the ground. You're dumping him on the ground, and you're staying on your feet.
Yeah, and I guess it's for scoring, though, right? They score that.
100%. And it's great to humiliate and to tire out your opponent. It really shows a lot of dominance when you're able to take another man off his feet and put him on the ground.
Absolutely. I'm not familiar with this, so it's great. I'm learning a little bit here. I'm not embarrassed to say it.
It's a unique sport. And it's cool because they do, cater to the fans in certain aspects with the sped up, take all the clinch out of it.
High pace,
that I
high,
like because it's exciting and they know what they're getting into. So the fans probably get rabid for that shit.
So this is what I was trying to say before, and it came off a little bit wrong. So a lot of the MMA fans, they get a little bored when the fight becomes more of a technical, like, ground game fight. But they're not, like, the fans aren't catching on to Glory and Lion fight. Like, the fans aren't understanding that if that's what they want to watch, you have that outlet. You have that venue. But they're not going to that venue. It's really strange. This is the only country where kickboxing, like Glory style kickboxing, it used to be K-1 in Japan. And Muay Thai, this is the only country where it's not humongous, dude. They're filling up stands with like 50,000 people in other countries.
Yeah.
We got
do they have any promotions on the UFC Fight Pass? Do they show any of these fights? Because I know a lot of the UFC Fight Pass air a lot of different fight organizations, regional, but I don't think they do anything for the Muay Thai. It would help put them
I
on
really
the map
don't,
for
I,
sure.
I can't speak on that. I have no idea.
I think Fight Pass has Glory.
Glory. They signed a contract with Glory. I don't know what they show, but I know. Which is absolutely ridiculous, man. That Glory was on Spike TV, dude, and that was like the perfect outlet for.
Yeah, you know, like.
Well, I think it's also on. Isn't it on ESPN too?
Other
channels.
ESPN, ESPN Dos Echos or some shit like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's like late
ESPN
at night. Yeah, like in the morning, you'll see the shit.
Yeah, it's ESPN Black Belt TV or some shit.
Bro, but I watched Conor McGregor fight for the first time, for Cage Warriors on MSNBC late at night, time. Like, this is where I watched, you know, I love that shit. When you turn that on late night, you put on, like, MSG, and you'll see.
Yeah.
That's where I think they air a lot of the kickboxing or the Muay Thai, MSG or MSG too, late at night, always have that shit on.
MSG has the WCKC, I believe, or WKC. It's an event that's out west. And there's some really high-class Muay Thai on that, on that one. And then now Lion Fight is on Access TV. And Access TV is a big channel. I mean, everybody's got it unless you're a douche and you have DirecTV, you know what I mean?
Right.
Everybody's got Access. So we're on that, and that's pretty cool, you know?
Yeah, no, that's definitely awesome. Something I'm going to look
anytime I see any type of fight on, I watch it. I can't help it.
Absolutely.
I'm so into all the, like, whatever, any combat sport. I'm just absolutely into it, man. I love boxing.
Yeah. I used to be a bigger fan of boxing before MMA came huge. But, you know, I'll still enjoy it. Hey, listen, like I said, the art form of the fight, whatever style it is, I appreciate. You were right when you said when it goes to the mat, the more than the average fan, the fans at the venue, fans at home on TV, watch on TV, they get bored when it's on the ground. But if you get two masters on the ground working each other through transition sweeps, like, that's gorgeous to me. Like,
You ever notice how you see a fight like that and the fans boo, but the fighters that are involved in the fight have this, like, dogged look on their face, like they just went through a war, and they have so much respect for each other because they really did just go through a fucking war. When you're
100%.
Engaged the entire time, you don't know what that
fighting
does to your body.
You're literally fighting
for
a little bit of balance here and there, and that's all that
it
is.
Yeah, like fighting for space and position and inches and leverage, and like, yo, that shit takes every last bit out of you. You're engaged the entire time.
Let me say something on this, because you guys are into BJJ. Every time I have an MMA guy who comes to my gym, because I did a lot of pro, like, MMA dudes who, like, let's say they have, like, a big Muay Thai fighter opponent.
Guy,
that's, like, really
yeah, they'll train their Muay Thai.
Yeah,
because
that's the
Muay Thai
to work with
yeah.
And the one thing, the one common thread that they always say is the clinch work that we do in here is very, very similar to jiu-jitsu.
Wow.
Because of all, there's a lot of arm locks, a lot of headlocks, there's a lot of body positioning for inches, like you just said, the leverage that we have to use to try to throw each other.
Head control.
So wrestlers and
jiu-jitsu
guys, they love coming in to do clinch work with us.
Well, that's why you'll see a lot of these jiu-jitsu schools, you know, especially mine, it's Muay Thai and jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, and like, I mean, you see a guy like Anderson Silva, he's got the best clinch, and you wouldn't notice, you wouldn't look at him and be like, wow, his clinch is great. You would think that a wrestler, you know, these guys that back in, like, a Chael Sonnen would be able to fucking toss him around in the clinch, but no, man. His Muay Thai clinch work is insane. Even Rich Franklin
Chael
back
Sonnen,
in
the... Chael Sonnen tossed him around that first fight. He beat the
shit
out of
him. Yeah, but Chael Sonnen was all sauced up through the fucking gills in that first fight.
Hey, and Silva could have been, too. I don't buy that.
You can
read that with somebody.
You could really make somebody look stupid by beating him up in the
valid
clinch.
Valid point, like, but I'm just talking referencing the clinch, really. Like, how good, you know.
And you know what's funny? I'll tell you something, dude. As far as the clinch in MMA, he does have a solid clinch. But if you put him with a same size Muay Thai guy, his clinch is very basic. It's just that when he was around, nobody in MMA was really familiar with it. Like, he got like a full plum on Rich Franklin. All right, a full plum, which is.
I was going to bring that up, but damn it, I was just going to.
And
that
it's like the first thing I teach kids on day one of clinch work. Is that how to swim, how to do a 50-50 and swim. So it's like so basic.
And the funny part is, Rich Franklin said that he was like, that was the strongest I've ever felt anybody in the clinch. And you said it was just this basic ass move.
So you get somebody in a plum like that. I invite somebody to get me in a full plum like that because all of their leverage is so high. All they have to do is sweep them out, and they're going to fall down. Like, it's just a basic technique. You know what I mean? I understand it was probably very strong, but Rich Franklin bent over at the waist, put his hands down to try to block fucking knees with his hands.
Yeah, dude. Like, he did everything that you should not do. And
all I'm saying is that,
gave up all leverage. He really did. It looked like he got real tall, and it looked like he just gave up all leverage, and it looked like he could have just got scooped a double and taken him down if he really, really.
100%. Dude, if Rich Franklin would have just, like, understood to get his hips in a little bit, and what am I saying? I mean, Rich Franklin's fucking one of the highest-level fighters of all time, right?
Yeah, but you know,
this one particular technique I'm talking about, if he would have just brought his hips in and you could sweep a guy out. I mean, whatever. It's the same thing as jiu-jitsu.
He was just mesmerized at that point, right?
Yeah, it could have been. Or he just didn't know how to get out of that bait. He just didn't train it. When I have MMA guys come here, they tell me they do not train the clinch ever.
Well,
so if you don't know what you're going up against.
When you train MMA, you tend to leave out the basics of, you know, like you're training a little bit of everything. So you really, it's easy to forget doing the basics of, you know, Muay Thai and then the basics of wrestling.
Yeah,
the basics.
Let me tell you something. Muay Thai schools in the States. In the States, they don't even teach the clinch simply because it's not marketable. When people come into your door and they see a bunch of dudes without their shirts on grinding up against each other, it's not an easy sell.
Yeah, no, it makes sense.
So guys don't do it.
It is when somebody eats a knee to the front of their face while they're sitting in that clinch and gets put on their ass. That's a pretty good
sell. Yeah, but that's the thing. A lot of these guys aren't tough. They're going there to learn to, like, not get beat up. So they go to practice, and the first thing that happens to them is they get the shit beat out of them. They're probably not going to come back. So you almost, like I said, now it's a business for people. You know, like, you don't want to kick people out of your gym and make them feel unwanted there. You want them to come back,
dude,
in confidence, you know. So,
and it's a real funny balance, dude. Like, because I need my guys to get as much work as they can get in, because obviously everybody's got a life and they can only train a certain amount of time. But I want somebody on day one can come into my gym and train with my best fighter
and
not
feel
intimidated. Yep, 100%.
Well, is your gym open to the public currently? Or?
Yeah, we're moving on Sunday. So I'm going to take the month of January where I'm just going to train the team. And then February 1st, we're going to have a grand opening for, like, kids and the public and everybody like that.
Yeah, I wanted you to kind of touch on, you said local teenagers or young kids that are, you know, from the area, you might offer them up a discount or whatever, trying to draw up some popularity.
Yeah, I live in Keensburg. It's a blue-collar neighborhood, and a lot of the kids don't have the resources to do, like, some of the shit that more affluent kids can do, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so I'm gonna have two rates. I'm going to have a rate, like, and whether people think it's fair or not, I don't care. I'm going to have a rate for non-residents, and I'm going to have a rate for residents.
Nothing wrong with that, man. That's actually I applaud that, because there's nothing wrong with giving back to the community that you, especially if you grew up around there, you know. In Woodbridge is the same thing. It's like the township. You have to be, if you show your license, you live in Woodbridge Township, you get a discount. It's no different, you know.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's awesome.
Just so we get this straight.
Mike, you're our guest. We want you to talk as much as possible. You always take precedence here. If someone's trying to cut you off, verbally beat him up through the phone and shut
him up. Yeah,
yeah.
Dude, you guys, this is what you do for a living, dude? Like, so you guys, your verbal sparring is on another level. I can't get on that with you guys, man.
Yeah,
back up.
Yeah.
I get the back up.
I wouldn't say living, but
no,
yeah.
You
will.
You have these kids that are local to Keensburg or whatever, like, what you're doing is taking them off the street, giving them an outlet to do something, and the discipline of it all, it makes you a better person. It teaches you how to defend yourself in the right way. You're not going to go bullying people once you're in a gym training.
Yeah,
so,
for sure. We're really big on that, man. We're really big on that. And I'm also subleasing I'm giving the township an opportunity to come in, and they're doing their rec wrestling in the gym also. I'm giving them.
Yeah, I was going to mention that because I remember you mentioned that yesterday. That's a great thing, man. That's great. And it also – it helps, you know, down the line you get these kids started young and they're in that environment at a young age. It might be something that they otherwise would never be, you know, introduced to is a good way to
put
it.
100%. 100%. I never wrestled a day in my life. And when I started training, when I started subleasing Rhino Wrestling in Morganville, the owner was Mike Malantonico. He's a wizard in wrestling. And, dude, I would just sit there and watch his practices. And the respect level that I have for wrestling is out of this. It's off the
yeah,
chart.
Dude, that's the hardest thing I ever did was wrestling season every year because just it's different. Cutting weight for 3 months straight. It's not like you
dude,
have a fight and you have
to.
You're hungry for 3 months. It's a new. It's just a different animal.
Rhino wrestling, if you were part of Rhino Wrestling under Mike Malinconico, he wouldn't let you cut weight.
I wish he was my motherfucker. You got to drop 30 pounds, you know?
No,
I wish he was my high school coach.
I would watch him get into it with parents and being like, listen, your kid is fucking 12 years old. We are not starving or dehydrating.
Yeah,
child.
Man. Like, the
so
worst time you could be
wrestle.
Losing weight is when your kids are growing.
Yeah, he would say feed them and let them fucking wrestle a weight class up.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know, it,
wow,
it,
that's
it,
good. That's good.
So I developed
you'd
a lot of respect for wrestling.
That's
why
some crazy
I want,
fucking parents are.
Jesus.
I don't want to get into it. But that's why I'm bringing in the wrestling program. I want that culture in my gym, and I want to. I think Mike Malantonico and Ryan.
Yeah,
Mike Malantonico was like on another level. I want to bring the culture that he had when he used to own Rhino, and I want to bring that type of culture to Keensburg for their wrestling program.
That's amazing.
Respect. Much respect. Especially we're all local to that area, not necessarily.
And you'll see, what this will do wonders in like 10 years down the line, 15 years down the line. You'll see the payoff when all of a sudden they're a powerhouse in wrestling in the state. Watch. You know, you see things like that. It starts young, man. Like, you get a good wrestling youth wrestling program. That's what happens in South Plainfield, Roosevelt Park. These kids don't play soccer and football. They wrestle when they're, you know, when they're 4 or 5 years old.
I was actually a public school teacher in Plainfield for 13 years. So I watched what was going on next door at South Plainfield, and their wrestling program was phenomenal, man. And, like, we had a really good basketball. We had a very good basketball program. Their wrestling program was out of this world, man.
That's how I had my knee folded the opposite way against South Plainfield.
Shit, good bastard.
Mike, you taught over on 22 at Plainfield High?
Can you say that again? I didn't hear
you. You taught on Route 22, Plainfield High, you're talking?
I was in the middle school, Hubbard Middle School.
Oh, okay. Cool. Nice. No, it's all right there. You know, the whole area is so. While Plainfield is big, you know, with that Plainfield and South Plainfield, but the area is kind of right there. You know, you go down one street, you're all of a sudden right in the next town. So.
Yeah, and it's crazy because you couldn't have two different demographics. From Plainfield to South Plainfield to North Plainfield, it's the craziest thing I've ever seen.
Absolutely, it's completely different. Both male and female. You know, it's just
like
it's two worlds.
Yeah, Plainfield was rough. That was a rough town, man.
Absolutely. But hey, man, I lived there for I think 6 years, and they're trying to clean it up. They're, you know, they're trying to do things there, but you know, there's always going to be pockets where there's bad things happening. But you know,
yeah, there's some great people. 100%.
There's going to be a valley. So
yeah, just got to keep doing things like what you're doing. You know, trying to help out kids in, you know, who might be in need, and opening up gyms for these programs to get better and to provide better.
My buddy, actually, first day, my buddy Rasul Wilson owns a gym in Plainfield. He was also a phys ed teacher in Plainfield. It's called Uplift Fitness. And he does the same thing, man. He's doing wonders for the community. It's called Uplift Fitness. If anybody's in the area, his name's Rasul Wilson. He's doing great things for the kids over there, man.
Nice. And that's in Plainfield or South?
Yeah, that's in the right part of Plainfield. Yeah.
Okay. Well, then good. You know, he's definitely giving back because, you know, there's so, even if there's 10 kids that get brought into there and change their life that way, that he's touching 10 kids, which is huge. It's huge.
Yo, dude, yeah, touching 10 kids is a fucking felony, bro.
I was thinking it as I'm speaking.
You gotta choose your fucking word.
I swear I thought Tommy would be the one you clicked. I thought it would be Tommy, you bastard.
The real this awful shit back in.
Rasul's gonna come kicking my ass. Rasul's gonna be knocking on my doorstep like, what are you saying? I'm touching 10
kids. Only a matter of time. The show fucking goes off the track.
Now,
as soon as you start talking about touching kids, bro, it's fucking done. It's a wrap.
Well, Carl always wanted to be a Catholic priest. That was his dream.
Oh, hey. Young.
We cross all boundaries here. There are no lines. There's nothing sacred. It's all out
there. Yeah, we got a little too serious there. See, last night would have been a better show because last night I was all fucking doped up, bro. I was on NyQuil. I had like 2 beers. It was a crazy night.
Yeah. You seem a little more subdued today, but it's
beers,
whatever.
Me too, man.
2 beers and NyQuil.
Absolutely.
You had a NyQuil, like 2 beers? Fuck that.
Dude, I was like, I'm conscious. I don't even remember talking to you guys.
It was short. That's why we all got cut off so quick. Tommy screwed that up, but whatever.
I'm a little disappointed that my region didn't shut down the server again today.
Yeah, well, you know,
we're
fine.
Not.
You got to go out.
We're not because we were pretty pissed off last night. That's for sure.
We were all set
to like leave Blog Talk and everything, but we'll discuss that later.
No, I swear I was so embarrassed, Mike. I was like, I can't believe we had him on and it crashed. Like we look like jerk offs to this guy. Like I cannot believe it. But you know, thank
dude,
you for
I
doing
wasn't
good
even
going
to call back today. The level of unprofessionalism I experienced with you guys yesterday. I was
you know what though? At least
I was
least
on. I was on, dude. I was on Stern this morning, right? So I'm on Stern this morning. I'm like, these fucking guys last night, you know what? And I told them the whole story, bro.
You know what, though? At least it didn't crash when we had the real fighters.
Yo,
any
press talking on Stern, huh?
It's the low-hanging fruit. It's the first thing. Anybody who doesn't like me, they go to. He's not a real fighter.
See, so basically what he's saying is, Tommy, you're not creative. There was no thought in that joke. Save it for somebody else. That was a terrible joke.
You see, that was, you understand my intelligent humor.
Oh, absolutely. I was going to say, even from talking to you yesterday, definitely a cool dude. We seem to have a lot in common in that regard. You remind me a lot of myself, you know. Like,
wow,
oh,
I think
that's
so.
That's a bad thing. That's it.
The smartest guy in the room. So you find yourself being the smartest guy in the room most of the time.
Every time.
Not in his own mind.
That is 60% of the time.
He finds himself the smartest guy in the room right now because he's the only guy standing in the room.
No, but honestly, Mike, I feel bad because we have another host, Omar, who's the silent partner right now. I don't know if he wants to chime in or not, but he's actually a good dude, and he was on last night. But you're definitely missing one quarter of our show, and he does bring some funny shit with him too. So you're actually getting solo a little short here, but you know, maybe we have you on down
the road. Is he the one with the daycare?
No, that was Tommy yesterday.
Tommy fucked everything up last night.
He fucked.
I know.
He had a kid on. He brought his parrot. He X'd out the admin box and didn't tell anybody. I'm on the phone with the Blog Talk.
Then he hits the fucking self-destruct button and the whole thing goes fucking.
That's what I'm saying. I'm on the phone with the company and they're like, I think your administrator closed the box. I'm like, he said he didn't.
Uh-huh.
Like, I think he did. I was like, yeah, okay, I figured.
They know, man.
Oh man. So honestly, if anybody's out there is interested in changing their life around and going to actually put pants fist to pad and get a good workout in, go to his website. Just Google search the Institute of Muay Thai, Kingsburg, New Jersey.
Oh, real quick, I love the plug, but I gotta correct you guys on something. And it sounds so weird, but there's no of. It's just the Institute.
Okay. The Institute Muay Thai.
And that comes from, do you want to hear the story about how we got the name? We went down to WKA's, which is the Muay Thai tournament down in Virginia, going back like 5 or 6 years ago. And I didn't have a club. I was just training fighters at the time. I was like a paid mercenary where a fighter would pay me to, like,
in the middle of his prayer. Omar, you're better than that. Omar, you're better than that. Go ahead, Mike. Continue. Sorry.
That was a weird sound. That sounded like Star Trek Phaser.
So that means we have a caller on the line.
It's the sound of a caller, but I wanted him to finish his thought because we're butchering his name for his gym. So he's saying, I'm curious as to why he had that name. So continue your thought.
Sorry. So we go down there. Our dudes end up being, like, extraordinarily technical. Somebody was busting my balls on the drive home. And, you know, we won a bunch of fights. We were really successful, but we didn't have, like, we were no real gym. There was no name to us. There was no, we were just guys, whatever. And somebody said, you know, we should call it Mike Burke Institute of Muay Thai Technology because the whole, they were technical. Like, it was just a funny joke at the time. And one thing led to another. Somebody prints a shirt. Somebody does this. Somebody does that. And all of a sudden, we ended up being the Institute, and it sucked.
So it's the Institute, like colon Muay Thai, or just the Institute?
Well, it is the Institute Muay Thai, but we just go by the Institute, and there is no
Muay Thai. Ben, it's my mistake. I just saw the logo. It looked like the Ninja Turtles
dying
logo.
Dying over there?
It's Pete. I saw the Ninja Turtles
no,
logo.
That's
it looked
that's
like
not
they
Pete.
Made. Well, somebody sounds like they're dying online, but caller, state your name. We got a caller online. What's up, buddy?
What's going on, dude? It's Macho.
Macho!
Oh, Macho, what's up, buddy?
Yo, what did I tell you fuckers? I said no fighters have to call in. Fire your fucking screener. Fire the screener right now.
No, you can thank me, bro. My brother's always welcome to call in to dish out on you.
Hey, our producer put the call through in the middle of our guest speaking. I think that's a little Bush League. No, I'm just kidding, Omar. But Macho,
you know,
what's good, man?
Let me introduce the caller, goddammit.
Yeah,
this is my
go.
Show. This is my show tonight. So, here's the story. So I'm training at Modern Martial Arts. I was part of Weapons 9 and Modern Martial Arts at the time. And this fucking scruffy dude comes in, right? Tries to sign up or whatever. And we start working in the clinch. And he's getting really serious, right? So, you know, obviously, I fucking throw him on his head a bunch of times, right? And after that happens, he's like, hey, you know, my name's Macho. Do you think you could train me? Do you do private?
that is not what happened.
It's 100% what happened, right? So
Macho's
actually the very first fighter that fought under the Institute banner.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah,
good
he was
shit,
our
man.
Very first dude. I had
that
other fighters that I trained that we went to fights, and I trained them in fights. But as far as actually being announced as the Institute, Mike was the first one.
Good man.
Nice.
The man who needs
oh, yeah.
no nickname.
History was made.
Yeah, yeah man.
And
all it took was
at the fight at the Garden?
For a couple rounds.
Macho, how do you like training under Mr. Burke here?
Oh, man. It is my experience with Mike is it's amazing, man. You know, like he is by far just he's a hard trainer. I mean, he really like pushes you to your limit, but at the same time, like he really really cares about you, man. Like he goes above and beyond for you. You know,
this is all
like,
bullshit. I totally paid him. I give him an envelope full of cash and
I'm I'm getting emotional over here. I'm all emo. I love him.
He's a great guy, man. He, what was it? When I met him, you know, I was completely just not even going to fight or anything, you know, like, actually a buddy of ours, Teddy was the one who told me to go to Modern Martial Arts and that's where I met him. And, you know, the rest is history, man. From there, we just, we started training and then our team started coming together and, you know, he's a great guy, dude. He's hard. Like he's the only one that can like really, like, I mean, we're all crazy when it comes to pads, when it comes to training and everything like that, but when he's on you, like, literally, like, white on rice, man. He does not let up on you, you know, but he literally cares about you so much, he will not stop, you know, like, he always has your best interest in heart.
That's good. That's definitely,
yeah, train hard for
definitely what you want. Yeah. Right. I mean, it seems like you guys are very family-oriented, like I said before. And you know, of course, any team aspect gets that way after a while. You guys coagulate and you gel into that type of bond, if you will, So it's good to see that it actually, you know, what he says isn't a lie, because he's been on this show for about an hour now pumping himself up and, you know, to get confirmation from one of his fighters. Actually,
no,
really
I got to give him credit. He did mention his team. He was mentioning his fighters first.
Yeah, he did. Mm. He did.
He mentioned everybody except Moscow, though. What the hell was that about?
Testify to this. That's the one common theme that you'll always hear when anybody talks to me, is that this is about the fighters, and that's it. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, but you mentioned everybody except Macho. What the hell?
No, man. Well, he's not really fucking, look, dude, he's married. Right?
And listen to Tommy trolling the shit out of people. That's all he's doing, all the troll.
He comes around every like 3 or 4 weeks explaining. He hit pads today for like 6 minutes, and I thought he was going to fucking die, bro. He's puking all over the place. Dude.
I've been away since my last fight in June, so I haven't been training or anything. So yeah, of course, what was it? I go in today, I'm hitting pads, and I'm like, I'm dying. Jesus, take the wheel.
Dude, Macho fought in how many people in the world can say this? Macho fought in fucking Madison Square Garden, dude.
Yeah, that's what I brought up earlier. I don't think anybody heard me though.
I thought
he was
going.
I think I totally stepped on your toes when Macho walked in. I got so excited to hear his voice.
That actual truth, you did fight in
was that the first fight under the banner?
No. The first fight under the banner was in like a garage somewhere in like fucking North Dakota.
Yeah, I like it.
I love it.
Oh yeah,
awesome.
No way, dude. This us getting to the garden was a long, hard road, man. First
fights in a garage where you wrap ropes around your fist, dip them in glue, and then glass, like in a kickboxer.
That's a real amateurish, like rookie choke. That's like if you're doing something technical, saying it's a flux capacitor, to be honest with you.
It's all good. Whatever. We've been trading jabs the whole way. I love it.
So, Macho, give us some good stories about Mike. Come on.
Oh, man.
Put him on the spot, man.
Tom, put him on the spot, throwing him under the bus.
Before you call into a radio show, you got to have, like, some fucking material. Like, I wrote shit down.
Yeah, you definitely. Yeah, Macho, what's up, bro? You got to come prepared, dude. You got to have some material. Wow, you can come kick my ass.
Yo, I got to tell you, listen, I respect your guys' show so much, and I respect what you guys are doing. I'm not going to lie. I took my kid's iPad last night so I could do a little bit of research on this UFC card that's going on, because I didn't want to sound like a total fucking dumb.
I wanted to ask you about the card. I just didn't know. You said all this MMA shit. I didn't want to put you on the spot saying, like,
no,
oh, what do you think
dude,
about this fight coming
up? I sound dumb all the time.
He could bullshit his way out of it.
Let me ask you a question, Mike. We talked about this earlier. Do you think that Amanda Nunes is getting shortchanged here because, you know, the fight poster says Ronda Rousey,
who?
She's
who?
Back.
Who? Who?
Yeah, exactly. The champion.
Ronda Rousey.
Ronda Rousey.
Oh, gotcha, yeah.
Ronda Rousey's opponent, basically. I don't even know her name at this point.
Dude, she's like a paid opponent. They have those in boxing.
Already in the ring? She's like WWE already in the ring opponent?
Yeah, she's
like
the Iron Mike Sharp. She's currently in the ring.
Dude, it's an absolute shame. This chick is a monster. I don't know if she's going to win or not, but she's an absolute monster. She deserves a shit ton of respect. She's a great fighter. She's the first.
No, she's getting introduced second, man. You know, like,
yeah,
right?
She's a champion. And how about this? Let's take it a step further. She's the first openly gay athlete in the UFC.
Right.
Openly gay champion. There's another. What's her name?
Liz Carmucci, somebody was telling me.
Yeah.
Carmucci, yeah. No.
There's a lot. Tisha Torres, Raquel Pennington. There's so many, you know, openly gay ones now. It doesn't even matter. But not that it matters then either. To me, it doesn't matter at all. But
it sounds like you're pretty fucking bigoted by the comments.
Yeah, he's trying so hard to reel back on that one.
I already touched 10 kids, all right?
Yeah, dude. You're about to go to jail.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so it is. As being somebody in the game, I guess, as Macho and I are, it's frustrating to see somebody who works so hard. And she, like, Ronda Rousey gets a different set of rules. And this girl, like, isn't getting the respect that she deserves, in my opinion, you know?
Yeah, she finally gets to this level. I feel like she should get some airtime. She should get some FaceTime out there. You know, you fight the biggest star in the world. Right. In women's MMA, and she doesn't even get her face on a fucking poster.
She handled the shit out of Misha Tate, too. It's like,
She busted that girl up, the poor girl. Like, she broke her friggin' shit with that shit, that right hand, man. Oh, my
she
God.
I do think that Ronda's going to take this girl past 2 minutes and she gasses out. Like, you see her diminish greatly after
the first round.
And then this comes out, guns blazing, and then she shoots. I don't want to say that because I guess that's the wrong term.
Don't
shoot
any loads.
She's
a blowing
wad. So, Macho, let me tell you something. I don't know if you guys know this about Macho. He is a huge, or at least he used to be. I don't know if he's probably going to change his story right now. He is a huge fucking Ronda Rousey nut hugger.
Oh, yeah. I'm not going to lie. What was it? The girl's amazing. She was until she got her ass fucking knocked out. You know?
Oh, come on.
And I mean,
no,
she's
not even
that.
No,
dude,
not
I
even
that.
Had so much more respect if you would have just stayed she's fucking amazing. So what? She got
no,
knocked
she
out.
No, she is. She still is. She is still amazing. She got knocked out. This is a fight game. You're not going to have a perfect record all your life. You know, what was it? It doesn't happen that way unless you're Mayweather, you know? And even Mayweather, what was
That's
it?
Right.
He'll probably come back and take an L.
Exactly. Like, you know, the girl has done so much for women's MMA. You know, like she has.
Yeah.
You know, you can't say that she hasn't. She's
agreed.
A champion regardless of the belt or not. You know, like, is this going to be her night tonight?
Yeah.
Hell, I'm a fan. I hope it is. Can she outlast Nunes with a gas tank? I guess we're going to find out in a couple hours, you know?
Connor said it that night.
He tweeted out when Ronda lost. He was like, anyone who makes that walk, you know, like, this is the crazy sport, man. It's like people are coming out there to take you out.
Dude,
so anybody that takes that walk, you know, got my respect in that aspect of it, at least.
Exactly.
You'll never hear me say, like, what's your record? You'll never hear me say something about wins or losses. Fuck that, man. You know what I mean? It's about who you're fighting, how hard you're fighting.
Yeah.
And a lot of these, well, Ronda's fought the best in the world. Each time she's fought the number one, you know, I guess outside of Cyborg, but, you know, she's fought who the UFC put in front of her each time out. It didn't look like she was really ducking anybody. She did wipe out the division. She called out Holly Holm and said, I think she deserves a shot. You know, so it wasn't like she was going after weak competition. She was going after the best in the world.
Well, I don't think she was going after weak competition, but I do think there's something to the fact that there wasn't much competition for her.
Oh, of course not.
I think she was on. Yeah, her judo shit was on another world class level, and
yeah,
the women's MMA as she was coming up just wasn't at her. She was.
I think like a couple of the young hybrid fighters, the Juliana Penas, they're kind of like, I feel like they're grooming them a little longer than normal because I think that's the next wave and they're gonna end up being able to take Ronda's of the world out.
Ronda was lucky because she was basically, I don't want to say in the background, but there wasn't women's MMA, you know, rewind to 10 years, whatever ago, and she got to really hone her skills since she was young. But by the time she came onto the scene, she already had a skill set that was...
But Gina Carano was taking the world by storm, and Ronda said,
and Ronda,
like, I could beat her.
Right. And literally, like, you know, being that Ronda's mother was a champion back in, I forget what skills she used to fight, and I definitely read up on it before. But she was
a judo
champion.
Right, oh, bro.
It's in her pedigree. So, you know, it stands to reason that she's going to come out and be that tough. So she really is lucky
Ronda,
in the situation she is. But the advantage,
full advantage. Ronda's the only successful judoka that's ever
judo
been
player
in MMA.
I mean, Carl Parisian had somewhat success.
He never won a belt.
Parisian had
success
to
champion.
A degree, but, you know.
Yeah, but,
you know,
so he's
Ronda's
saying the most
the
successful
judo
is definitely Ronda.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, he never had
marketability.
A fraction of
because you hear a lot of people say that judo's kind of beat in MMA because it's like they say it's like light jujitsu. You know,
it's like kind of like people say jiu-jitsu is like light sambo.
Dude, that's stupid. Like, if somebody says that shit, that's stupid. Judo is like, that shit's fucking legitimate. Like, it doesn't matter. It's like, it's fucking legitimate. And I'm not saying
it's
legitimate.
If you take that shit serious, it's all legit.
Please.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't think you're going to win a fight if you only know judo. But if you're really good at judo and you can do some other shit, like, she's proven, like, you can do some fucking damage.
Well, the throws are insane. I mean, you leave your feet
bro.
In an instant.
Dude,
yeah.
So imagine if you have a little bit of boxing where you can close the distance, you've got fucking ridiculous judo where you can put somebody on their head, and then you've got enough jiu-jitsu where you can submit them. It's fucking magic. It's awesome.
I'll tell you what, I've never seen
basically.
Hips. Ronda Rousey has the best hips I've ever seen in my life.
Gina
you know,
Carano's hips are so much better, bro.
Yeah, well,
it depends how
it's you're just
which,
saying
which
that because
you're
she's
at,
a Muay Thai chick.
Dude,
yeah, it depends which angle.
Dude, she's so gorgeous. I love her so much.
Oh, my
man.
God.
Yeah.
I am so in love with her. Absolutely.
I'm glad
her
better than her acting.
I should have known that my hip statement was going to go that route.
Well,
you know,
I still have Gina Carano in my mind because you brought her up a minute ago.
Yeah.
Hey, Masha,
that weigh-in picture where she's, like, biting her bottom lip.
Oh,
God,
dude,
she knows it.
I'm in the gym alone.
She knew exactly what the fuck she was doing.
Hell yeah.
I can't take it.
Macho, real quick, I don't want to keep you on forever, but do you have any social media you want to plug so we can get some followers following you in case you ever decide to get back at it? Get some people maybe coming to check you out.
Well, the only thing I'm gonna say is like I mean the institute is gonna be we're gonna be busy this coming year. You know, we've got John Esposito and Frank Wells fighting coming up soon, along with Malcolm Hill and Eric Jung. These guys are animals, man. John has been my training partner for years. He's a beast. You know, he blasts people, and you always know he's going to hit you hard. You know, Frank is, you know, he's the youngest one on the team besides the two little kids that we got now. But, you know, like he's the 155 champion at Warriors Cup, and he's coming to bring it, man. Like he's just an amazing fighter. You know, Eric, this is on Warriors Cup. Warriors Cup, and are we doing Friday Night Fights, Coach? Is that the other one?
Yeah, so Eric and Malcolm are going to be on Friday Night Fights, and John and Frank are both championship fights for Warriors Cup.
Yeah.
And that's both coming up this month, or when are the fights?
That's going to be in February.
In February.
February
2nd,
I think, is Friday Night Fights. February 18th, I believe, is the Warriors Cup.
Yeah, like,
if you guys want to see fucking good Muay Thai, dude,
I was
going to
say, we should try. Where are they? Are they local?
Warriors Cup is going to be Queens. It's at the Queens Theater by K.
That's good.
And then
Friday Night Fights
at the Broadway Ballroom in Manhattan.
Absolutely.
That's obviously local enough. I want to go to at least one of them.
Honestly, you want to see good Muay Thai. Both those shows have some of the best Muay Thai in the country.
What'd you say, Tom?
If you guys post links, then we'll definitely share it. The show, like each one of the hosts will share it separately. You know, like we'll get the word of mouth out there. We'll do what we can for you guys.
Yeah, maybe help some tickets.
Yeah, no,
that'd be
exactly.
Awesome. Yeah, and honestly, we got to get the sports to grow, man. Like we touched on earlier, if MMA fans really want to see people stand up and punch each other in the face, they've got to catch on to Glory and to Muay Thai.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So much.
Mach, you know, you and I got a score to settle, right?
All right. So, what was it after? I'm completely healed from. You already know what I'm going through. So. After that's all better. What was it? You know, we could do it in the gym. We could do it on the show. Wherever you want it, baby, I got you.
You guys want to fight on the show?
Yeah, I'll be okay. We'll put it on the show. Tommy will be
How great would that be?
Tommy will be answering questions from the guard.
Yeah.
Hey, man, we're never going to get to do it in the ring professionally together, so we might as well just do it wherever we can. But.
Dude,
I'm down.
Yeah, let's do it. Dude, I'm so into marketing and promotion. Holy shit. Let's do it in the gym. Have your guy live broadcasting from the gym.
Yes.
You guys kick the shit out of each other.
Hell yeah.
I'm 100% with that. 100%.
Yo, Mike, kick him in his bad leg.
If I kick him in his bad leg, I'm going to break my leg. Screw that.
Anderson Silva.
For real.
The man who's been banned from all Muay Thai leagues because of his steel shin.
Screw the Muay Thai stuff. We're just going straight to jiu-jitsu. Come on, you took jiu-jitsu.
Oh, God, no.
Hold on.
Wait, why not?
No.
What kind of balls is that, bro? You're calling him out in your field. You won't let him bring his
action.
We'll
do an MMA. That's fine. We'll do an MMA. So then if you get it to the ground,
I'll do an MMA. I'm not going to do
Yeah, and then that's what we'll do to make it fair, Tom.
Kick the shit out of you in MMA.
Listen, make it fair. We'll start one round on the feet, and we'll start the second round in the guard.
I love it.
What is this, bully beatdown?
Bully beatdown.
Oh, my God.
Fucking, it's so funny you say that, because Mayhem Miller is my spirit animal.
Really?
Dude, I love that guy coming up 100%.
Well, Macho, you heal up. You heal up, and we'll have some fun.
Definitely, man. What was that? I'll be back before you know it.
Good.
Shit, I'm going to start training Macho for this thing now. I'm so
Did I hear somebody getting into a car? Is somebody driving right now?
What happened?
Someone getting into a car. I thought I heard someone getting into a car.
I think Macho.
Oh, no, I'm pulling up. Yeah, I'm pulling up to the bar. What was that? Because we're going to watch the fights.
Respect, I love it. Well, thanks for calling in, brother. I don't want to keep you from your beard. Definitely.
Thank you, guys.
I appreciate you calling.
Hey, don't try to steal my airtime next time, bro.
Seriously. Well, what was it? Thanks for having me on the show, guys. Coach, I'll see you Sunday at our new place.
Hey, listen, anytime you want to call in, brother, you're always welcome on my show.
Later,
all
right, guys. Have a good one. Love you, man. Have a good one.
Mike, I'm real comfortable doing this podcast thing. You ever think about maybe deciding to host your own show one day?
Yeah. No, I never thought about it. No.
Dude, how about
until now?
Yeah, right. I'll take your jobs in 5 years, though.
Yeah,
build this shit till it gets really big. Then have me on. Then I'll take the job.
Absolutely. That's fine.
Dude, how fucking awesome is Mach? What a fucking awesome dude, right?
Yeah, he seems cool, dude. Now, Tommy, did we go to high school with him?
Yeah, dude. He lived
next to Mach.
He lived right on my street in Colonia.
Right. No, I remember him. We used to definitely chill a little bit. I just don't know if he remembers me per se. Like, you know, he might remember if he's seen me. I look the damn same, so whatever. But,
everybody knows the Gucci.
I think you're thinking of a different one.
I might be thinking of a different one. I mean, I know the dude used to fight, so whatever. But yeah, the last name translates well, you know, good or bad. You know, some people have good memories, some people don't, but whatever. But, hey Mike, I don't know, but like people could find this number and email on the internet, but is that how they're supposed to contact you if they want to sign up for the gym? Just go on the site and dial that number or email you or whatever, because I can plug it, I can give it away for you if you want.
Yeah, for sure. That's my cell number, but absolutely, man. I don't think you guys have enough listeners, or I'm going to be getting any prank calls, to be honest with you.
Oh.
Damn, jams are coming. All right, so his number's 555 Eat a Dick. You want
LSD. He must be friends with homeless Uncle Pete. He's taking shots at us. You hear that?
Right? Him and my cousin got together and freaking decided to talk shit. I love it.
Yeah, wow. 555 Eat My Dick. I'm going to get t-shirts made with that on it now.
Oh, that would be great. I want one. Extra large. In the arm area.
Muay Thai. Muay Thai. 5-5-5.
5-5-5. Yeah, I love it.
I love it.
Oh, man,
dude.
So that's good. I mean, we're basically, you know, I don't know how much longer of the show we really got. Oh, we're basically freelancing at this point. So, I mean.
Yeah, we're about to cut off.
I think Omar's NyQuil'd out.
Yeah, hold on, have we been doing something other than freelancing at this point?
I love it.
You know what? I'm going to say this on here right now. Mike needs to call in every week and do a segment.
I don't mind that.
That's what I'm saying.
I'll give you guys once a month. How's that sound?
That's fine with me. That's more than
once
enough.
Once a month, we'll do like
say.
A Muay Thai minute. I'll come on and tell you guys about all the cool shit that's going on in the world of Muay Thai.
Once a month, the worst time of the month. How about that? The worst time of the month for a married man and the worst time of the month for the show.
Fucking perfect. I'm in. We'll call it
1 minute.
Yeah, we'll call it that time of the month. That's what we'll call it.
Look at how organic that was. That's beautiful. That's how real it was done.
Muay Thai minute, that was too generic. That time of the month, that's fucking
good. Yeah, that time of the month I like. You need to be a catcher, right? You need someone to be like, what does that mean? And they look into it and they're like, oh, okay, cool. That's what you need.
Yeah.
But,
I love it, dude.
No, but, Mike,
no, but I
really
absolutely, appreciate you. I really appreciate you guys having me on. Like I said, it's an honor. I really love what you guys are doing. The show is fantastic. It's really entertaining.
So
I always tune in.
And you're always welcome back on. And hopefully, you know, as we grow, as we, you know, continue this show, we get better. And you know, we'll have a finished product eventually one day. But I really appreciate you coming on, especially in the early onset stages of the show and really helping us out. Hopefully,
yeah,
you can return the favor by getting
man. We'll keep co-promoting each other. Like, we're a young club. We're nobody in the game right now. So, you know, whatever help you guys give us is awesome too, man, right? It's all love, man.
For the rest of our days, you have a promotion machine, a marketing machine with us. I will always share your shit that, you know, needs to be shared. Anything pertaining to your gym or whatever, you have our word that we will get that out there for you and do what we can for you. You definitely help us out, so I do appreciate that. And
I think we need to get him a 2-minute warning shield on his fighter shirts when they walk out. I don't know.
Oh, just me. That would be badass, dude. That would be badass.
What do you think, Mike? Hey, how about this? You guys know you see like we have a pretty good social media presence.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you get me a banner, a 2-minute banner? You know what I mean? And I'll put that up in the gym. So as you know, all of our videos go out, your banner will be up.
Actually, I have a banner already in my
absolutely.
Chris has one when he makes his Al Qaeda videos.
Yo, that's so funny.
You guys,
he said Al Qaeda because we put the banner in the background with a flag and shit. And it just looks—it has that look and feel of like a weird, like you know, we're going down.
Somebody's getting beheaded, right? Somebody's getting raped,
right.
Or somebody's getting beheaded.
right. With all due respect, nobody. That was you can have that banner. And I can't believe you said that. Thank you so much, dude. That's great.
No, you know, I'm working with a couple different vendors like Meal Plans to Go, Urban Ninja, Muay Thai Addict, and Beast Coast. Johnny Fasina's Beast Coast Unlimited Gear. I'm working closely with all those guys, and you know they've treated me really well. And you know I want to show my love to like people who treat us well by putting their shit up on our walls because I know we're on social media like crazy. You know what I mean? So
mm-hmm.
I'd love to do the same thing for you guys.
I appreciate that, man. That's definitely a good look. And
that's
hopefully
awesome.
We can continue that cycle, just everyone passing around, go back and forth, helping each other out. That's what.
Yeah, that's it, man. That's the way we grow.
But yeah,
at this level,
go ahead, Chris.
No, I said at this level, that's what it's all about.
Yeah, it really is at this point. We're just trying to help each other. But, you know, I don't want to bore our listeners too much. Mike, thank you so much again for coming on. You have a happy new year and go enjoy the fights tonight, what's left of them. And hopefully we'll talk soon.
Absolutely, man. I really appreciate it. And let's, you know, give me a date for next month, and I'll be more than happy to come on and talk some Muay Thai.
I love it. Thank you very much, Mike.
Thank you guys very much for having us on, and thanks for having Macho on. That was very cool.
Absolutely. The Institute.
Take care, man.
Mike Burke. Good man.
All right, guys. Good night.
All right, later. Dude, what a stand-up guy. I really enjoyed that
awesome.
Interview. He's definitely a cool dude. And with all due respect to George and Eddie, he's a class act. I think we have potential here. He's a lot of fun. He's a lot of fun to interview because he gives it right back. He jabs it back, and you can tell him he'll take one, too. You can jab at him, and he's not going to get his panties in a bunch. So that's a good dude right there.
We got to get him
but,
that banner, Chris.
Oh, absolutely. That was such a good idea. I'm going to definitely sign that banner, and I know Trish is going to be very happy about that. So, yeah, we'll definitely get that going. And, you know, I guess we're at the point here. I mean, we're going on an hour and 40 minutes now, so we really don't have to continue much longer with the show because there are fights that I want to get to and I want to look up. Tommy, if you could send me that link for the streaming, but that would be great.
What streaming?
And,
we don't. What streaming? What are you talking
about?
No,
where we stream our videos, the show back.
Yeah.
But yeah, guys, get out there and you know, join the 2-Minute Warning group on Facebook and make sure you follow the Institute Muay Thai. Friend request Mike Burke. If you want to change your life with some Muay Thai, go on there and look up the website. You got the phone number and the email address and get yourself together on that one. But guys, happy new year. It's a great show. I'll talk to you guys next Thursday. And we got big things on the horizon for 2017. Might change format on the on our end in terms of what we use for production, but that's neither here nor there. Hopefully there's no more hiccups. Tommy, Chris, thank you very much. As usual, great interview. You guys both helped out. Just cut him off every single time, which is awesome. He's living up to the hype. Omar, I know you're in the background right now, but thank you so much. You're doing a great job.
Hopefully you get better, and we can have you on next week, and it's going to be business as usual moving forward. Didn't have Drunk Uncle Peter. I don't know what happened to him today, but, you know, I guess he's probably listening from afar. But either event, Happy New Year, guys. Everyone stay safe and enjoy.
All right, guys.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to cut you off.
10 minutes too late there, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Whatever. What are you going to do? But, yeah, I guess I'll talk to you guys. I'll talk to you, Tommy, in a little bit. Chris will talk to you in 2 minutes.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Enjoy these fights.
So,
yo.
Later. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.